So I'll ask first to come and speak with you, our CNO, but I'd like to tell you just a little bit about David. David's been chief nursing officer since 2001 here, and he has, in his areas of responsibility, nursing and patient care services. He's been with UTMB since 1983 and has served in every role within nursing, from staff nurse all the way to CNO. He earned his bachelor's from University of Texas in Austin and his master's from UTMB. He graduated from the South Texas College of Law in Houston, Texas, and he is certified in nursing executive practice, has two certifications in that area. He's active in many, many local professions and professional organizations. He serves on numerous boards and committees around the country for AONE and for the University Health Consortium. He also does a lot of community work and is the past chair of the Galveston County branch of the Greater Houston Area Chapter of the American Red Cross. And so he's been out on a number of missions of mercy to help when there have been disasters, deployed in Florida and deployed in New Orleans. David's a very caring professional, and we're proud to introduce him as our chief nursing officer. David.
Thanks, Dr. Davis. I guess I'm close enough you can hear. At least it's reverberating up here. Wow, more than 400 people here. We are so impressed and so thrilled about your commitment to give up a Saturday to be here to further your professional development. It's really, truly inspiring. So I am pleased to welcome you to our UTMB Health Campus. 2008 was the last time that we were able to do the annual school health conference. And then in September of 2008, our campus was devastated by Hurricane Ike. We had about 3 feet of water in most of our main buildings on campus, and really are just now recovering. More than $1 billion worth of damage has been estimated to have been done during that storm. So we're proud to be back, and now you're a part of it. This week, the American Nurses Association announced that it was partnering with the National Assembly of School-Based Healthcare to celebrate National School-Based Healthcare Awareness Month. Not a week, a month. Well, I don't even think a month's long enough to recognize what you do. It probably needs to be recognized every day. We want to salute you as UTMB for what you do to keep our children healthy so they can be successful both in school and out. Those of you who have attended this conference in the past know that I have been privileged to do sort of a welcome and introduction over the past several years. And you may remember that I shared fond memories of my school nurse that I grew up with from first grade through high school, Mrs. Vanita Smith, RN. You know, Ms. Smith's on Facebook now. And we recently friended each other. And at last check, I was sort of upset that she had more friends than I do. Apparently, a lot of the students who knew her as their school nurse were very fond of her, and they still stay in contact with her. So the theme of the National Celebration of School-Based Healthcare Awareness Month is Share Your Story. And so I was thinking on the way here today about the stories that you guys could share, and I wish you would share them and publish them so that we could read them and know more about school-based healthcare. I think it's important as funding dwindles for education in Texas that we make sure that our children have access to excellent school-based healthcare. And the part that you play in that is incredible. And we can advocate on your behalf if we know the stories to tell. So please consider writing your story and telling it for us. I want to acknowledge the preparation that went into today's conference. Preparing for more than 400 people to come on a Saturday morning is not a small feat. And I would leave people out if I tried to thank everybody. But I want to highlight the collaboration that Pat already mentioned between nursing service at UTMB, the UTMB School of Nursing, and the UTMB Department of Pediatrics. Those three groups have done an incredible job of making an outstanding program for you today. I want to thank you for taking what's a precious Saturday, I'm sure, to focus on your development and networking. It was interesting. I know you guys were networking when Pat started talking because I could hear you. And I thought maybe it was that group of people I passed in the Alvin ISD school, van. I tried to get out of your way the best I could, but it was kind of foggy out there, you know. Welcome to Galveston winter. We hardly see the sky in the winter here. I also want to thank our presenters today. We've got some expert presenters for you, and I know that the content will be meaningful to you and make a difference in your practice. I also want to thank Pat Davis, especially for being behind this planning. I've sort of been on the sidelines from the beginning when there was talk about, well, is it feasible for us to do this now? And then there was a needs assessment. And thank you for those of you who participated in the needs assessment. That provided the foundation for planning today's events. So thank you. I also want to thank, there's several volunteers here today, a lot from nursing service at the hospital. I think more than 40 volunteers. So thank you to the volunteers. And for you in the audience, don't hesitate to ask them if we can do something to make your day better. Please ask the volunteers that are around. So without further ado, I'll turn it back over to Pat, and once again, welcome to the UTMB Health Campus.
David mentioned the volunteers. They have on purple ribbons today. The speakers have white ribbons, the volunteers have purple, and I'd like to ask all of our volunteers that are here in this session now to please stand up so you can identify who those folks are. Thank you so much. Dr. Watson, the Dean of the School of Nursing, could not be here today, but she has been extremely instrumental in supporting what we've put together for you. Many of her faculty are presenting today and contributing to the program. They've been part of the planning committee, and I would like to have Bonnie Webster. Bonnie has got her bachelor's in nursing from the University of Iowa, her master's from Texas Women's University in Dallas, and she has had 34 years of continuous nursing experience with or in pediatric healthcare areas, so is quite a pediatric expert. She's been part of this planning from the beginning, and she'll be involved in some of the hands-on sessions that you have later today. But she's going to offer remarks on behalf of the dean, who sends her regrets and congratulations for having the conference. So, Bonnie.
Thank you, Dr. Davis and Mr. Marshall. As you know, my name is Bonnie Webster, and I am faculty at the School of Nursing here at UTMB, and I do teach undergraduate pediatrics and nursing informatics. And on behalf of our dean, Dr. Dean Watson, who is out of town, and as Dr. Davis said, does send her regrets for not being able to be here as we have come back after the storm and are very happy to be back here. We are very glad that we've been able to work together to bring back this conference after our 2 year of recovery from Hurricane Ike. And from looking at you all out there, it seems as if you are glad that we are back as well. Thank you. We have a diverse group of presentations today, which reflect the results of the survey that Mr. Marshall talked about that many of you completed a few months ago. So we are very excited to present some of those topics today. The good news is that we have breakout sessions this afternoon, but the bad news is we have breakout sessions this afternoon. Each of the three sessions that we have, that we are providing, will have excellent discussion regarding the care of children with special needs. The challenge, I am sure, that you found was to determine which one to attend. As you know, much good information will be presented in each one of these. But don't forget to go back to our website, the conference website, because outlines and slides of the presentations are presented there, so you can grab some of that information and download them. The planning committee, and especially the Nursing Education and Research Department, have worked very hard to make this conference happen, but seeing so many of you out there has made it all worthwhile. I would like to recognize, finally, all the work and care and love that many of you provide to the children in our school settings. It is a job that does not get the recognition it deserves, as truly you are all unsung heroes in so many ways. As pediatric nursing faculty, I would especially like to thank you all for allowing our students to work with you, with the children in your schools. The opportunity for our students to work with you in providing things like hearing and vision screenings to the children is a win-win-win for all concerned. The students report back to their classes that school nursing is much more than they thought it was. And they are actually in awe of all that you do and all of the opportunities you have to influence the health of children. So thank you so much to those many of you that we ask to facilitate us, to help us educate students, for that experience and that role modeling. And we hope to continue that ongoing relationship. So once again, welcome to our conference and welcome to our island. Thanks to those of you who live off the island for crossing that causeway, even in the fog. We are sit back and enjoy this great learning opportunity. Thank you very much.
Okay, and last but not least, definitely not least, Dr. Patricia Rogers, achieved her MD from Vanderbilt University in Nashville. She's been a faculty and content specialist here in the Department of Pediatrics and Family Medicine. She's also an active member of our annual School Health Steering Committee, and she's made significant contributions to the teaching mission of the university. She serves as a mentor and faculty preceptor for numerous residents in the Department of Pediatrics, as well as medical students, acting interns, and nurse practitioners. Dr. Rogers is a very gifted and caring pediatrician with a special affinity for child health and advocacy. Dr. Rogers.
Good morning, everyone. We are more than thankful, and thanks, Pat, for that introduction, that you are all here. We welcome you again, and I'd like to echo everything that the previous speakers have said. Many of you know Dr. Rick Rupp, who was previously our school health director for our residency program. I am now Dr. Rupp. I know I don't look much like him, but I'm Dr. Rupp. Feel free at the end to ask me any questions during the day, because I will be here. All of you know of academic teachers at school, and I want you to take a minute and think of yourselves as teachers as well. I'm a teacher, but you guys are teachers, because you teach kids about diseases that you see. You teach parents, and you also have had an active part in nursing, our nursing students, as well as our residents in pediatrics. As Bonnie said, it is a win-win-win-win situation. Sometimes you're the first line people to see many diseases. particularly for kids who don't go to see their pediatrician. And for this, we thank you. We've prepared a program to hopefully enlighten everything you have seen or things you may not have seen. But most of all, we thank you for caring for the health of our children. Thank you.
Okay, David mentioned to you the survey that was done, and from that survey, you indicated that you needed and wanted to know about the scope of practice. What are the expectations for your role? What are the things that you need to be focused on as you provide care in the schools? And so we found Dr. Melinda Hester. Dr. Hester got her BSN from University of Texas in Houston, her master's from University of Oklahoma, and her doctorate in nursing practice from Texas Tech University in Lubbock. She focused her doctoral work in executive leadership, and since 2005, she has taught jurisprudence and ethics workshops for the Texas Board of Nursing throughout the state. So I think we have an expert to speak with you today, and I welcome you, Dr. Hester.
Thank you, Pat. Good morning. I'm so happy to be here with you. I'm a school nurse. And I think I've met many of you before, so I'm particularly, I feel like I'm at home and with friends when I have the opportunity to talk to school nurses. I did leave school nursing in 2005 after about 14 years. I felt like I needed a new challenge, as you may appreciate and have made changes before. I found that as my son left high school, my only son, one and only child, that I needed a new challenge. So I applied for a job at the Board of Nursing, and that has become my second passion after school nursing and after children. And I hope to share some of that with you. I don't know about you guys, but when I first learned about the Nursing Practice Act and rules and regulations, my eyes glazed over. Is that a fair assessment? Yeah. So numbers, the law citations, and all of that are sometimes intimidating. But what I have found out through learning about those laws, that when we know our Nurse Practice Act and our rules and regulations, we are able to protect the children that we serve by keeping them safe, and we protect ourselves when we do that. And I think that's very powerful. Don't you? So I want you to hear that today, that when you understand these laws, you're protecting not just the students and the staff at your schools, but also you're protecting yourself. And so what I have today are some stories, and I believe the best way to learn about those laws and those rules are through stories, because those rules and laws were written by attorneys, and they don't always make sense. I'm sorry, David, but sometimes that's true. So I think stories help to really reiterate what those laws mean. So I want to tell you some stories about what has happened to some school nurses. And then I want you to think about how you, if you can relate to those stories, what do you need to do to change? We also know that when you know how to prevent those errors from occurring, you can protect those students from future harm. So it's very important that we do learn from nurses that have had disciplinary action or who have made mistakes in the past. I think that's how we all improve our practice, is learning from others. So I'm excited to be here, and I do have a few door prizes. So at the end, We'll do that as well. Okay, let me get organized here. You all may be aware that there are 335,000 nurses in Texas. Did you know that? About a third of those are LVNs, two-thirds are RNs, and about 1 to 3% of that number is reported to the Board of Nursing every year for some sort of a violation that someone thinks is a violation. And as you know, anybody in Texas can report a nurse at any time. What I want you to also hear is that of that 1 to 3% that are reported every year, 60 to 70% of those cases never are opened or investigated because either there wasn't enough evidence or the nurse did the right thing. So I think that's also encouraging and positive that I want you to take away with and not be fearful. We know that in Texas there are 4.5 million school children every day that you take care of, and 17% of those have developmental disabilities. And I'm going to be here today as well, and I hope to hear your stories, and if you have questions, I'm happy to talk with you. I did have the opportunity to talk with the health service coordinator of Dallas ISD recently, and she told me that in her district, there last December, there were 481 pre-K children with developmental disabilities that had some sort of a special treatment or procedure that was needed every day in school. 481 children. That was December of 2010. In 2011, there were 681 children. So something's happening, as the data is showing, and you may be noticing that in your school districts as well. So it's even more important that school nurses are in those buildings now. As of September 1st, there were 5,915 school nurses in Texas. And they were RNs, so almost 6,000, and 1,452 LVNs in schools in Texas. So we know, and I know, that you face very challenging and complex situations every day. I know what it's like to have to see 75 children during the flu season. I was at a middle school in Round Rock, and I had about 1,100 students. Plus 100 staff, and we know that you take care of everybody in that building, not just the students. I wanted to start with this. Practice isn't the thing you do once you're good. It's the thing you do that makes you good. Nursing is a practice discipline, and you must practice in order to become an expert. And I want to challenge you to be sure that you're helping the new school nurse and you're precepting someone or that you're friending someone and helping them as they grow in that school nursing practice because you all have an expertise to share. This is the objective. And then I want to highlight the board's mission, and I know many of you are aware of this. It is to promote and to protect the public welfare and to protect the safety of the public in Texas. And many times people ask, well, who protects the nurse? And I was asked that just this week by a school nurse that was actually angry. And oftentimes I'm the messenger, so I hear that. And I understand that feeling because the board is in existence by law to serve the public. The board also believes very strongly that when nurses understand the law, when they're following the law, when they can apply it, that the public is safer. So we have a department at the board that focuses on teaching like this. So we're talking to you on the phone. I hope I've spoken with some of you on the phone. We're answering emails, we're helping with workshops, we're teaching webinar live meetings. So we're trying to get the message out because we know that education helps prevent errors. So the Nursing Practice Act, as you know, is the law. That's your foundation. That's what you build your scope of practice on. And the Nursing Practice Act is based in statute. The legislature creates that with input from the professional nursing organizations, and individual nurses also contribute that as well. The NPA is written very broadly, as you know. If you've tried to read it, it doesn't really specifically talk about school nursing. It talks about nursing in general. So it is a challenge to read and to understand at times. And that's why we then have the rules and regulations. Rules and regulations are written so that they're easier to understand, and they help operationalize that Nursing Practice Act. It helps to interpret what that occupations code actually says. The laws, the statutes, and the rules are equally enforceable. The rules are written all the time and can be amended at any time. We as nurses are required to know those laws all the time and to keep up with those changes. So how do you do that? Meetings like today. How many of you are reading your Board of Nursing bulletin? Oh, yay. And are you turning, the very first thing you turn to is the back? That's okay. We hear that all the time. People want, they're looking at that, those imposter pictures, right? And that's important because I don't know about you, but I've worked hard for my license and in my education. And if there's a person out there that doesn't have a nursing license and says they're a nurse, that makes me angry. And it should you, because it affects the profession and it affects the health, safety, welfare of the public as well. So your bulletin is another source for you to get up-to-date information. Your employer is another. Articles, anywhere you can grab it. I hope that you focus on staying up-to-date and current. And then, of course, we need to always let you know where stuff is on our website. How many of you have been to the website? Oh, yay. So hopefully it's on your desktop favorites. And I know that does sound funny, but there really is information that you could use every day on there. And we're going to talk about it in just a sec. So under Nursing Law and Rules, you'll find the Nursing Practice Act, the rules and regulations, and then the Nursing Practice area of the webpage. And this is all the information that you'll get there. And I'm proud of it. We work hard on this type of information, and there you'll see guidelines, position statements, the safe harbor information, nursing peer review, delegation, all kinds of good stuff. So I hope you'll put that on your favorites and refer to it often. These are the position statements that I think are specific to school nursing practice. So I wanted to highlight those for you so you'd have those in your handout when you go back and download that. Many of you are initiating standing orders, so there's a position statement that helps you get your program in order so that you have all the components that you need for standing orders. There's a specific position statement for school nurses, and the duty of a nurse in any setting is another topic. Nurses engaging in the reinsertion of a permanently placed feeding tube. How many of you are doing tube feedings in your schools? And I know you're excited and interested in this afternoon's breakout session. And then the administration of medication and treatments by LVNs. And then the last two position statements are brand new. It's on the LVN scope of practice and the RN scope of practice. Those were written partly with you in mind, because we know that staffing is a difficult thing right now with the budget cuts. So in the back of this position statement, you'll notice that there's a chart, a side-by-side chart with the LVN scope of practice, the associate degree nurse scope of practice, and the Bachelor of Science nurse scope of practice. So we're hoping that will help you as you educate your unlicensed administrators and school boards in what nurses do, and that there is a difference between the scopes of practice. How many of you are advanced practice nurses here today? And how many of you are registered nurses? And how many are licensed vocational nurses? And then are there physicians in the audience and unlicensed folks? Okay, so primarily RNs. And then we have guidelines. There's a guideline on transitioning into a new practice area. And many of you experience this every year. You've got nurses that are coming from other practice settings into school nursing. And I hope you'll, again, mentor and guide these folks as they enter. And then there's one that is very helpful if you're hiring new nurses, newly licensed nurses into school health. And I really want to caution you against that, if possible. The practice of school nursing is a specialization, and the board believes that before nurses move out into the community setting or independent living environments like school health, home health, that LVNs and RNs have a period of time in structured settings like hospitals, nursing homes, rehab centers, clinics, where there are other RNs that can guide and influence their practice. Because as you know, school health is a very autonomous, very independent setting, and there's no one there. You're on your own, right? You may have somebody that you can call on the phone, but there are places in Texas, and I hear from those nurses, where they don't have anyone that they can call. So it's vital that folks have some experience in structured settings before they step out into that independent living environment. And then additional resources that are specific to the school nurse are on our website. And then I included this as you're developing job descriptions, orientations, contracts, whatever you need as far as delineating between the LVN scope of practice and the RN scope of practice, this document may help you develop what the competencies are for those nursing licensure levels. And the document is at this link on our website. I'm going to focus today on Rule 217.11, so I don't want you to glaze over, but I do want you to know that number, 217.11. That is the standards of nursing practice. These standards are what form your scope of practice. So this is what you wanted. You wanted to understand deeply what your scope of practice is in the school health setting. So this is the rule you do need to know. And I think it's exciting. Once we start talking about it and you start hearing these stories, I think you'll appreciate it. That rule talks about what is the definition of nursing, what's the definition of the RN and the LVN. And as you know, the RN is a professional nursing role. It's an independent role. The RN develops and implements the nursing process. They supervise, coordinate, and delegate. And then you'll also find this in the Nursing Practice Act. And this is the section of the rule of the law where you can find that right here. And then the vocational nurse has a supervised practice. It's a dependent role. They assist in the development and the implementation of the nursing process. And then in the Nursing Practice Act, you'll see where this is defined. So the legislature has defined that. All right, now let's talk about the four sections of this rule that we're going to talk about, the standards of nursing practice. The first section has the 22 standards that we will talk about in depth that apply to all nurses, advanced practice nurses, registered nurses, and LVNs. The second section is specific to LVNs, the third specific to RNs, and the fourth to advanced practice nurses. The second section, as we talked about just a minute ago, highlights that the LVN has a supervised practice. And the law says that an LVN has to be supervised clinically by either a registered nurse, an advanced practice nurse, a physician's assistant, a physician, a dentist, or a podiatrist, and that they work in predictable situations or with predictable clients. And we often are asked, well, what does that mean? What does predictable mean? School health isn't predictable. And I certainly understand that, and I've been doing a lot of educating people that it is not Band-Aids, because they honestly, they think that it is. And we need to get that story out that it is not just first aid. It is chronic disease management, it's emergencies. There were days that I thought I was running a minor emergency center, as you know. So predictable means unchanging, non-fluctuating, stable. So there are clients, there are students where LVNs could take care of in school health settings. And if we use asthma as an example, asthma has a very well-defined disease process or course that a student will follow with asthma. So the LVN can plan and prepare and take care of children. They can anticipate what will happen with a child with asthma. LVNs work in settings with well-defined policies. So I hope you're working on your school district policies that will help guide and direct nursing practice. And that's a big issue I see in disciplinary cases related to school nurses. Many times there are no policies and procedures. There was nothing there to guide the nurse. How many of you do have a policy and procedure manual, whether it's electronic or in paper? Okay, you'll hear that a lot this morning. That's very important that you have that for that direction. The LVN assists in the nursing process. The LVN performs focused assessments. That's a face-to-face, targeted assessment using all five senses. It's an appraisal of the situation at hand. They participate in the planning of the nursing care. They participate in modifying the care plan, and they implement parts of the nursing process. And they assist in the evaluation of how that client responds to the care plan. They can also assign and supervise daily tasks, while the RN in school health retains that overall responsibility for the coordination of care. And then the scope of practice for an RN, as you know, the RN is responsible for that nursing care plan. They're developing it, actually physically developing it. They're making comprehensive assessments. And a comprehensive assessment looks different than a focused assessment. It's at a very deeper, much deeper level, and it's bigger. It's this big. It's looking at not just the student and the symptom, but what's going on in that student's life, at home, in the environment. RNs are trained to evaluate populations, communities, so more than just a symptom, for instance. They develop nursing diagnoses, they develop care plans, they implement care, they evaluate the client responses, and they delegate to unlicensed staff. And then the advanced practice registered nurse is trained at the graduate level, and they are trained in a role and a specialty. So for instance, they may choose a nurse practitioner role, anesthetist role, a nurse midwife, or a certified nurse specialist. And then they specialize in a population like pediatrics, acute care pediatrics, for instance, or women's health, or just pediatrics, or family health. So it's they pick a role and a specialty, and then through their advanced education, are able to engage in aspects of medical management of that condition that a client is experiencing. So now I want to talk specifically about those 22 standards so you know how to use them every day in your clinic. The first one is standard V of 217.11, V for verify. This is where nurses are required to ensure the verification of current Texas licensure or other compact state licensure privilege and credentials of personnel for whom the nurse is administratively responsible when you're acting in the role of a nurse administrator. So how many of you are health service coordinators or directors of nursing, or you're the team lead, or you're the lead RN in your school district? Do you have a system in place where you're checking nursing licenses? I hope so. And it may be your HR department, but remember, if you are in that administrative position, you ultimately are responsible from a licensure standpoint to be sure there's a process in place that someone is checking. And one example, and it is not a school nursing example, but I want to share it with you because I think it's powerful and you can apply it to school health. And it last fall, and this happens fairly regularly, but last fall a director of nursing called and I got the call. And she said, Melinda, I've just discovered that an RN that works for me in my home health agency does not have a current license and has been practicing on a delinquent license for 3 years. And I said, well, the first thing that needs to happen is he needs to cease and desist practice. He should not be at work because he's not a nurse. And she said, okay, we've done that. He's not here, he's not working, and he's begun the process of reactivating his license. And I said, oh, that's great. And I said, now, the other thing is you have to report him because he practiced for 3 years without a license. And fortunately, there are mechanisms where in many cases it's a corrective action and a fine when that happens. There's also ramifications for the administrator, the nurse administrator, who neglected to be sure that each of the nurses in her employment was currently licensed. So she ends up being disciplined as well, with probably a corrective action and a fine. It's not just licensure. It also has criminal ramifications because, remember, this is a home health agency. They're billing Medicaid and Medicare for the services of a licensed registered nurse, and he wasn't. So that's fraud, which is a felony in Texas. So it's very serious. And I translate that to school health because are you all billing Medicaid for many of your services? And Medicaid requires, if you're billing for nursing services, requires that nurse to be licensed. So it's serious, and it's important that you have a mechanism in place to be checking those nursing licenses. Ultimately, though, whose responsibility is it? It's the nurse. It's ours. Each of us must be sure that when our renewal is up, we're renewing, and we've got 60 days to do that. If we're going through a CE audit or the criminal background check audit, we have 90 days. We know when that's coming, don't we? Everybody knows when their renewal. It's in the, like mine, I was born on an odd year, so every 2 years on that odd year, I have to renew by the end of the month of my birth month. Put it on your calendar, put it in your iPad, your whatever you're using, electronically or on paper, and remember to renew your license. It's so very important. And then I want to talk about supervision and delegation. And this is standard U and standard S of 217.11, number one. Letter U requires that a nurse supervise the nursing care provided by others for whom that nurse is professionally responsible. So that's many of you. Whether you're a health service coordinator and you're supervising many staff, or if you're the RN on a campus and you're supervising unlicensed staff, or maybe you have LVNs that you're supervising. that applies in school health. And then standard S says that you make assignments to others that take into consideration client safety and that are commensurate with the educational preparation, experience, knowledge, physical, and emotional ability of the person to whom the assignments are made. That means you know your personnel. You know who you're making the assignments to. You know if they've been trained. You've verified the training, and you're confident in their abilities to perform the tasks that you're assigning to them. That's your responsibility when you are assigning and then when you are supervising. So very important. Supervision is the process of directing, guiding, and influencing the outcomes of individuals performing the tasks. It doesn't necessarily mean that you have to be physically present on the campus to be supervising someone. It depends on that person's abilities and their qualifications and their level of competence. You could provide telephonic supervision if need be. But we also are saying that at some point, physically, you may need to be present if that individual that you're supervising has difficulty or there's an emergency. So if, for instance, if you're supervising numerous LVNs on your campus or in your school district, can you, if they have an emergency, if there's a shooting, if there's some sort of a crisis on the campus, can you physically be there to assist? That may be necessary. And then delegation is the authorizing of an unlicensed person to provide nursing services while retaining accountability for how that unlicensed person actually performs that task. So that's a tremendous responsibility, isn't it? We are transferring the ability to perform a nursing procedure, a nursing task, to someone without a license. And yet we stay responsible for how that person does their job. I found that very scary. But I think that I got good at it. And I had to in order to get the work done. Because as I said, I had 1,100 kids. I had a lot of procedures. I had to train unlicensed staff to do those procedures. And then I supervised, I trained, I supervised. I did spot checks. I would go up to the functional life skills classroom and check on things. And honestly, there were some school years where I didn't feel confident in delegating, so I didn't. It depends on that unlicensed person and their abilities and how serious, how capable they are, how willing they are to do what's right for the student. Delegation doesn't include when you're physically present with that unlicensed person and they're assisting you. So when you're working side by side on something with a student, that's not delegation, that's assisting. Training does not necessarily mean that you're delegating. And I know there are situations for school nurses where you might be going around the district and training unlicensed folks in how to perform procedures. That doesn't necessarily infer that you're delegating, but you need to have that spelled out in job descriptions and policies and procedures. Does the school district think you're delegating when you're training, or are you just training? So I think that's important that you work that out with your employer and have it defined in your job description. And then supervision as well does not necessarily mean that you're delegating. We know that the education code permits principals to assign tasks to unlicensed folks, right? And then you find yourself supervising what that principal has assigned to the unlicensed person. So it doesn't necessarily mean that you're delegating when you're supervising. But again, that you should have that defined in job descriptions and policies and procedures. And then remember, when you choose to delegate, you are always training, always supervising. So when you delegate, you do train and you do supervise. But you can just train without delegation, and you can just supervise without delegating or without training. So I hope that helps. And then who assigns? We know that LVNs can assist in that process. They can make daily assignments to the unlicensed staff. However, remember, RNs have the overall responsibility and oversee and coordinate the services that are needed of the students on a daily basis. So what are the benefits of delegation? And I know I have people tell me there aren't any, I don't want to delegate. And I think we've gone beyond that in many school districts, and maybe you haven't yet. Maybe you're fortunate. I know I talked to some folks this morning where they still have an all RN staff and every campus is covered. And if that's the case, that's wonderful. But you know what's happened in the legislature this last session and the cuts that the education budget took. And it's not over. You know, we're still coming out of this recession, and we are faced with doing more and more with less and less, and not just in school health. UTMB is experiencing it as well. The home health community is experiencing it. And we've got to work smarter, and we've got to do more with less. And I think delegation helps us do that. We also know that it allows us to attend to more complex tasks that our children need of us. And it maximizes what we can accomplish. We also know that it develops those unlicensed persons' skills. And when they feel valued and they're developing competence and an expertise, they're likely to stay on the job. They have a higher job satisfaction. And we know that it promotes cost containment. So there are benefits and challenges. And I think the key to effective delegation is communication. It has to be a two-way communication. Those unlicensed staff have to feel comfortable that they can call you at any time, particularly if you're not there on campus. They've got to know that they can call you and talk with you about anything at any time. And then you as the RN needs to value their contribution. And that will begin to establish that trusting relationship. We know that delegation is a very complex skill, and it takes time and practice in order to master. There are lots of resources on our website about delegation. So I hope you'll look those up. And then on to Standard T. Standard T says that we accept only those nursing assignments that take into consideration client safety and are commensurate with the nurse's educational preparation, experience, knowledge, physical, and emotional ability. So there are two pearls that I want you to take away with you today. This is one of them. It's our responsibility when we sign a contract, when we take a job, that we are able to fulfill that safely. So those words up there, who owns your practice? We do. Each of us. You own your practice. I own my practice. That's part of being a professional. And it's our responsibility to be sure that we can do what we've said, what we've agreed to, that we have those skills and those competencies. So consider, this is a little story, and I want you to remember that these are little snippets, little snapshots or stories of what's happened to school nurses. Also keep in mind, it's only one factor. Usually there are many factors that go into a disciplinary action. But I pulled out pieces that I wanted to be able to apply to the standards for you. So consider the school nurse who was an RN that completed athletic physicals and was not authorized as an advanced practice registered nurse She wasn't a physician or a physician's assistant. The school nurse conducted her conduct misled students, family, and staff, and that she was not authorized as an advanced practice nurse to conduct the athletic physicals. And the student health condition may have been missed and could have resulted in harm as a result of the physical activity. So in this instance, the definition of nursing found in the Nursing Practice Act that we talked about earlier identifies that RNs do not engage in acts of medical diagnosis or the prescription of therapeutic or corrective measures. Performing athletic physicals is a medical assessment to determine if the student has an underlying disease process that might be aggravated or worsened should the student participate in a certain physical activity. So that's a question we get oftentimes. School districts are trying to save money, and they think their school nurse can sign those athletic physicals. So keep that in mind. When you are accepting assignments, we own our practice, and we need to be competent and skilled in the task that we're being assigned to. So that's one of the pearls I want you to remember today. Standard T, we're accountable for our assignments. The next section is the next standards I grouped together. It's G, H, and R. And those are all very similar, and it relates to continuing competency. So standard G tells us that we obtain instruction and supervision as necessary when implementing nursing procedures or practices. Standard H tells us that we make a reasonable effort to obtain orientation and training for competency when encountering new equipment, technology, or unfamiliar care situations. And then standard R tells us that we're responsible for our own continuing competency in nursing practice and individual professional growth. So you can see how all three of those standards really apply or are very similar to each other. And I know you're faced every day with different things and new things that you're doing. Is that right? Have you had something new this year happen to you that you've had to learn? A new piece of equipment? A new, some sort of new technology? Most likely, in school health, you do. And I want to tell you a story about what happened to me in the early 2000s. Remember when insulin pumps were coming out into the community? And they were just coming into the school? And you guys will be able to relate to this because it's probably your story. But I did not know how to use an insulin pump. And I had one of the mothers of my sixth grade students came in one morning, and she was all excited. And she said, "Melinda, our insurance company approved the insulin pump. It's going to be here in 30 days. And I was thinking, "Oh, great." I don't know how to do that. But, you know, I just said, "Oh, that's wonderful and okay." And when she left, I thought, "All right, now how am I going to learn this in 30 days? What do I need to do?" I'm responsible, not my employer. I'm responsible. Does my employer have a role in that? Yes, they do. And fortunately, I had an employer. I had a principal that said, "What do you need? What do you need to go out and learn this?" Which is another story about your administrator. Establish a relationship with your administrator so they will help you when you are in need. So I said, "I need to spend a day with someone who's doing insulin pumps." So I talked to the student's mother again, and I asked, "Can I spend a day with your doctor and the certified diabetes educator?" And she said, "That'd be wonderful." So we got permission. I spent the day in his office. He was an endocrinologist, a pediatric endocrinologist in Austin. I spent a day with the certified diabetes educator, and we worked on pumps all day long. And by the end of the day, I felt pretty good about changing the cartridges and the boluses and the insulin carb ratios. I ordered the VHS tape back in the early 2000s on the insulin pump. And I read the book, and the day he walked in, I felt prepared. of course, you know, he was the expert, the sixth grader, of course. He knew how to do it. But I needed to know how to do it if he had an emergency. So that's one example of how it's our responsibility to find out what's going on. And I know you guys have them as well. So nursing, which is one of the most wonderful things about nursing, we have to learn new things. And it's all through our life. Things change. And it's our responsibility to keep up and stay informed. Okay, standard Q going on tells us that we make referrals. We consult with, we utilize, and make referrals to appropriate community agencies and healthcare resources to provide continuity of care. This is one of the most important things I think school nurses do. We are now known as the public health nurses. We are in the trench. We are in that forefront as school nurses. You guys are right there on the edge. And you've got to know your community resources. You've got to know when to make those referrals, whether it's for vision, hearing, your spinal screenings, your immunization referrals, when children are ill, when there's a medical condition that needs to be referred, and oftentimes for those basic needs of housing, food, and public health services. We have to be prepared to make those referrals and then follow up. And that's an important piece. And I know that's difficult with the volume of children that we're taking care of, but that follow-up is also very important. So standard Q. Standard P tells us that we must collaborate with the client, members of the healthcare team, and when appropriate, the client's significant other, in the best interest of that client. And I think communication is the key here. And we know that communication is the number one reason in the United States why healthcare errors occur. It's communication. I think we can do better at communication as school nurses. We need to step up our efforts with our administrators and particularly with parents. I know there were days where I felt like I talked more to parents than I did to children. Do you guys feel that way sometimes? And that's important. We don't always see the children every day. There are those that we see every day, those whether they're the frequent flyers or those children that have treatments and procedures every day. But we are talking with their parents oftentimes, even if they're not in the clinic. So we've got to collaborate and work together in the best interest of those children. That's standard P. Standard O tells us that we implement measures to prevent exposure to infectious pathogens and communicable conditions. So how are your immunization programs going? How is your surveillance? Are you up to date on all your immunizations? How about influenza? Do you offer flu clinics at your schools? And what about your hand washing? The U.S. has really fallen down on the hand washing situation, and David can probably talk about this in the hospital system. We forget to wash our hands, and that's something very easy that we could do. Are you cleaning your clinics? Are you cleaning your stethoscopes? Are you cleaning those glucometers between use? Think about the school nurse who was recently disciplined in Texas for allowing a student with diabetes to use another student's blood glucose monitoring machine and lancets. The two students were not supervised while they were testing their blood glucose, and equipment and supplies were shared. You know, kids, we're teaching them to share, so they do. So this conduct exposed these students to infectious pathogens and communicable diseases. So the best practice in that type of situation is that needs to be monitored. Those children need to be supervised as they're testing each day their blood glucose. And equipment and supplies need to be stored separately. And they need to be taught not to share in those instances. Standard O, a very important part of nursing. Standard N tells us that we as nurses must clarify any order or treatment regime that the nurse has reason to believe is inaccurate, non-effective, or contraindicated by consulting with the appropriate licensed practitioner and then notifying that practitioner if we make the decision not to carry out that order. And in school health, that means also the parent. So when we make a decision not to carry out an order, we talk and collaborate with that ordering practitioner, and then we also talk with the parent so they understand why we believe it may not be safe. So standard N happens almost every day to school nurses because you guys are calling me, asking me, what should I do? One nurse in Texas was disciplined recently for administering incorrectly a student's insulin, which ultimately caused harm to the student. The school nurse failed to clarify the physician's order regarding the administration of Novolog when she was confused about how the order was written. She also failed to obtain a written order to obtain blood glucose testing. So, standard N, very important in nursing. Talk with that physician, call them on the phone, ask to speak with them, and find out. Oftentimes, you can work it out on the phone and get it situated very quickly. Standard M tells us that we institute appropriate nursing interventions that might be required to stabilize a client's condition or prevent complications. So, have you developed those emergency care plans for children with special health care needs? And are these emergency care plans included in your IHPs? A school nurse recently failed to appropriately intervene when a student with diabetes visited the clinic and the child's blood glucose reading was 39. The school district policy required the school nurse to administer carbohydrates such as orange juice and monitor the student's blood glucose until the blood sugar reached 70. The school nurse retested the blood glucose after several animal crackers and released the student back to class with the blood glucose of 58. And then ultimately the child began to decline again in the classroom and experienced harm. Another school nurse failed to initiate CPR on a student that did not have a valid out-of-hospital do not resuscitate order. So we've got to have our policies and procedures in place. We've got to know what the doctor's orders are. We've got to be prepared because as school nurses, you are first responders. And you must know how to intervene appropriately, whether it's in the management of a chronic disease or whether it's in an emergency. And I want to tell you a story that has happened here in Texas, and hopefully you'll be able to avoid this situation. As you know, staffing is becoming very challenging in school health, and many school districts are turning to home health agencies to supply private duty nursing in school buildings for those special needs children that need one-on-one nursing. Is that happening? And they assigned a student with a trach and on a ventilator to an LVN in a home health agency. And the campus RN said, wait a minute, we need to talk about this and plan for this. And the school district said, no, we know you're busy. We're going to take care of this. We want you to just focus on the other kids on the campus. So she felt that her hands were tied, and they hired a home health agency to provide an LVN. And the LVN was assigned to this student, began the care, and within a few months' time, the child experienced an emergency. And the LVN panicked, and the child died while the LVN was running to get the campus RN. And the moral of that story, or the what to take away from that is, who was supervising the LVN? Was the LVN trained and competent? And we found out later, no. The LVN had accepted that assignment, had never taken care of a child with a trach or on a ventilator before. The supervisor was back at the home health agency, and the RN had been told not to intervene, to not take care of this child, and yet that RN is the one that's the closest. And logic would tell you that that's who the LVN should call immediately if there is a problem. So by the time the RN did get back to the classroom, the child had already died. So we are telling folks there needs to be policies and procedures around contract staff. How are they oriented to your school building? Do they know about school health? What's done in an emergency procedure, in an emergency situation? Who intervenes? How does the staff work together in the best interest of that child to avoid that type of emergency in the future? And I think that's not going away. Staffing and home health agencies in school buildings is not going away. So I encourage you to develop your policies and procedures before that happens, so you all know how you're going to work together, because you are required to work together. Standard L, don't you love this picture? Tells us that we provide without discrimination nursing services to everyone in our school building, regardless of their age, their disability, their economic status, their gender, their national origin, their race, their religion, their health problem, or their sexual orientation. So school nurses take care of everyone. And literally, some days you feel like it is everyone that you are taking care of. And then Standard K tells us that we have a mandatory reporting requirement, each of us. And not all states have this requirement. And I believe the reason that this law is in place is because the nursing profession in Texas educated the legislature and said, we know how to govern ourselves. We know what's right, we know what's wrong. And each nurse has an obligation to report when there is some sort of violation. For example, if a nurse's actions may have contributed to the death or serious injury of a patient, or the nurse's practice is impaired by chemical or drug abuse, exploitation, fraud, or a professional boundary violation, or if the nurse lacks knowledge, skill, judgment, or a conscientious approach to his or her practice. So there are many, many sections in the Nursing Practice Act and then the rules that tell us that we have a mandatory reporting requirement, and we need to let someone know when we witness or when we suspect there is wrongdoing. That's what we do to protect the students and the staff in our building. And then Standard J tells us that we must know, recognize, and maintain professional boundaries of that nurse-client relationship. And we know that since 1999, every year since 2001, we have been the most trusted profession in the United States. And that is an applause. And it started in 1999, we got it in 2000, and then 2001 we didn't. And you know who did? The firefighters did, that's right. And I have to tell you, we have worked hard for that recognition and that distinction. And it's because we know how to develop that nurse-client relationship, and we know how to maintain those professional boundaries. And if you think about professional boundaries as a continuum, a line, and we strive to be right in the center, in that zone of helpfulness. But when we are on the right side of the continuum and we're under-involved, That means that we are not making referrals, that we're not reassessing our students. We're not talking with parents or administrators. We're under-involved, and that's a professional boundary violation, and children experience harm as a result of that. On the other end of the spectrum, when we're over-involved, no one else can do anything for that student. It's only us. We're taking students home with us. We're taking care of them on the weekend. We're doing things in secret. And that's over-involvement and is a professional boundary violation. So we strive for right there in the center where we do the most good for students and staff. We maintain that professional boundary. So we work to inspire confidence in the patients that we serve. We always work in the best interest of the student or the family, and we abstain from personal gain or personal benefit in that nurse-patient relationship. And the power that we have over a patient or over a student is from our position as a nurse and the knowledge we have in relationship to what's going on with that child or with the family. So we have to establish that professional boundary to maintain control over that power differential. And it allows us then to safely connect with that student and that family. What we're telling folks is this: a good rule of thumb is if you wouldn't document it, you shouldn't be doing it. And I say that we've had situations where nurses, not school nurses, but nurses are writing checks for patients, and then they're writing personal checks on the patient's checking account. They're emptying checking accounts, things like that, some very unethical, unprofessional behavior. And we don't benefit, we don't personally gain or benefit from the relationship that we have with clients. So we maintain those professional boundaries. And you know, I think it's hard for nurses in the community, I have to say, and I did start out in labor and delivery, and I worked in a hospital for a period of time, but I knew in school at UT Houston, UT, I heard somebody say, yay. I knew I wanted school nursing. I wanted to be a public health nurse in school nursing. And that thought just left me. That's my age. It'll come back to me, and I'll finish that thought in just a sec. Okay, let's go on. And standard I. Darn it, and it was probably important. Okay. Standard I tells us that we notify the appropriate supervisor when leaving a nursing assignment. So when we have to leave, we need to let somebody know, whether it's our health service coordinator or our campus principal, whoever you're reporting to on that campus, you need to let them know. The board has developed a position statement 15.6 that talks about alleged patient abandonment. The board gets involved when nurses leave their duty station, their work assignment, their work day, and they're leaving patients unattended. That's when the board gets involved. If you're turning in a resignation or you're planning on leaving a position and you've given notice, that's not a licensure issue, that's an employment issue. The board gets involved, and it could be a violation if you're leaving in the middle of the day. And that did happen recently. A school nurse came onto the campus, the premises, and saw that there was a new child coming to school with a ventilator and did not know. So, you know, you can imagine you come in on Monday morning and all of a sudden you have a new student that there had not been an ARD. There, you had no notice that this was going to happen. And so the nurse came into the building, called the health service coordinator and said, when I get help, I'll be back. And she left. And that's a boundary violation. That could be considered, that's reportable. So what she should have done, safe harbor, for one thing, And she would have to work then to figure out, how am I going to learn about this tracheostomy, this ventilator? How will I care for this student with hundreds of other children? But she should have stayed to work that out with her employer. But she left all the other students that day on campus without a nurse. That's a violation. So we need to notify our supervisor when we are leaving our nursing assignments. I love this picture. We talked about nurses are teachers. We teach every day. I think, again, that's one of the best things we do, whether it's teaching those little ones how to wash their hands, to teaching those high schoolers how to be safe and how to do things the way they should. So promoting that education and teaching is something that we do and I think are very good at as school nurses. This one we're not doing so good on, maintaining that patient confidentiality. And I have to tell you that we've begun work on a position statement regarding social media. And I would look for that to be out before the year's end. And we do have input from school nurses on our Nursing Practice Advisory Committee, so Julie Lindley will be providing input with the school nurse perspective as well. But we are required to respect the client's right to privacy by protecting confidential information unless required or allowed by law to disclose that information. So think about the school nurse who is recently disciplined for failing to protect the confidentiality of a student with diabetes, approached the student in the cafeteria where she was sitting with classmates and teachers, and she criticized her in front of everyone for her meal choices and the effect those choices would have on her blood glucose. School nurses need to be familiar with the confidentiality laws, HIPAA and FERPA. We need to know who our confidentiality officers are in our school district and work with them to develop policies that will guide nurses in protecting that information. We've had an explosion of reports over the last year of nurses being reported to the board for social media violations. And those are our young nurses who are just exiting school. So we're trying to get the message out that while Facebook and texting and everything is wonderful, we don't post pictures of patients, of their surgeries, of their wounds, of their new babies on our Facebook page. And even if we're not posting names of those people on our front page, they do know where we work, what shift we work, what school we work, and through deduction can figure out who we're talking about. So I want to read this little story. This didn't happen in Texas. This happened in the United States. A board of nursing received a complaint that a nurse had blogged on her local newspaper's online chat room. The complaint noted that the nurse bragged about taking care of her little handicapper. Because they lived in a small town, the complainant could identify the nurse and the patient. The complainant stated that the nurse was violating privacy laws of the child and his family. It was also discovered that there appeared to be a debate between the complainant and the nurse on the blog over local issues. These debates and disagreements resulted in the other blogger filing a complaint about the nurse. A check of the newspaper website confirmed that the nurse appeared to write affectionately about the handicapped child for whom she provided care. In addition to making notes about her little handicapper, there were comments about the wheelchair and the child's age. The comments were not meant to be offensive, but did provide personal information about the patient. And there was no specific identifying information found on the blog about the patient. But if you knew the nurse, the patient or the patient's family, it would be possible to identify who's being discussed. This situation illustrates that nurses need to be careful not to mention work issues in their private use of websites, including postings on blogs or discussion boards. The site used by the nurse was not specifically associated with her like a personal blog is. Nonetheless, people were able to figure out who this child was and who the family was, and private, confidential health information was disclosed. So hopefully, you're not waiting for the position statement. You are working with your employer to develop those policies and procedures now that guide the nursing staff on the use of social media. That's standard E. Standard D, documentation. One of those few standards where the letter actually stands for the topic. So as nurses, you know all too well that we are supposed to accurately and completely report and document the client's status, including signs and symptoms, the nursing care rendered, the physician, the dentist, or the podiatrist's order, the administration of medications or treatments, the client's responses to those medications and treatments, and any contacts made with other members of the healthcare team or the family of the client. Why is our documentation so important? One reason, there's two. The most important reason is that those that come behind us base their decisions and their actions on what you've done and what you've recorded. The other reason is, 5 years from now, would you be able, in a court of law, to remember what you did for a child? You need to be sure you're documenting accurately and enough so that it will recall in your mind what you did, because it provides that history and the basis for which others base their clinical reasoning and their judgments on. So think about a school nurse. This happened a few years ago. At the beginning of the school year, she had about 150 children that needed immunizations. So she went into the computer system and pre-charted on that day, October 31st, that they all needed to be updated by October 31st. So she put that date in the computer. And they all needed different various things, and they needed it before October 31st. So she put that in as her pre-chart date. And you know what happened? The school year got really busy. She forgot to go back and follow up with those students and actually get the correct date, whether it was August, September, or October, of those various immunizations. So she went on through the spring, and it got to the next fall when she started the same thing and she realized what she had done. So they went a whole year. Those 150 kids were not immunized, were exposed to communicable conditions and infectious pathogens, as well as those medical exemption students in the school building. So there was a risk for potential harm, and that nurse was disciplined as a result of that. So we avoid pre-charting. Many times nurses are disciplined for the lack of documentation. However, in one school nurse's situation, her case was actually closed because she documented accurately and completely. So I wanted to tell you a little bit about this story. A parent brought in an MDI, a metered dose inhaler, and signed the parent permission form with instructions to administer PRN 6 puffs of albuterol. Okay, everybody already knows. The parent asked the nurse to contact the physician for an order. The nurse made several attempts via phone and fax to contact the physician to clarify the order with no response. The school nurse carefully documented each of these attempts. She also tried contacting the pharmacy and documented those contacts. Interestingly, what the nurse investigator found, because she also contacted the pharmacy to confirm, the pharmacy was also having difficulty clarifying the order with the physician, and the pharmacist was also documenting their attempts. The school nurse followed up with documentation regarding her contacts, and with the parent, was documenting all the conversations with the parent, where she notified the parent that she would only be able to give 2 puffs of the MDI which was according to the manufacturer label, was the recommended dose. And as you may have guessed, the parent reported the school nurse to the Board of Nursing for not following their instructions. And remember, nurses follow a physician's order for medication administration and treatment administration. The case was closed because the nurse followed the minimum standards of nursing practice. Now you're going to know standard C and standard N, and demonstrated this with her accurate and complete documentation. So that was one of those cases, the 60 to 70% of the cases that our nurse did the right thing. She knew how to accurately report and document. So the best practice around documentation is to avoid pre-charting. Use care when you're documenting immunizations, hearing and vision, acanthosis nigricans, and spinal screenings, and the health status of your students. Remember that your documentation is a legal document that you're going to have to use in the years to come to recall what you did for students. How many of you are transitioning to electronic charting? Are you using only electronic charting? How many of you are? Not very many hands yet. And that's kind of par for around the state. So in your electronic charting, I hope you have input into how the software is developed. And I know. Is there enough space for you to record what you need to document in those notes section? If you're still using paper charting and documenting, is it legible? Do substitute school nurses have access to the electronic record? What are the policies for substitute school nurses in the documentation? What's your record retention policies? And they should be consistent throughout the school district. So I know I promised you that policies and procedures would be discussed all morning. I hope these are food for thought for you on what you need to go back and maybe clarify, embellish, beef up, so to speak. The next one, standard C, is that nurses know the rationale for and the effects of medications and treatments and shall correctly administer the same. Are you using the six rights of medication administration? A school nurse administered Adderall to a student from another student's prescription, which was also Adderall. The Adderall belonged to another student who had moved out of the school district. Another school nurse failed to keep the medication cabinet locked, where numerous medications were stored, including controlled substances. While the school nurse was out of the clinic, a student came in, self-administered, and later it was determined that it was the wrong medication that the student took, and harm resulted. Another school nurse left the medications out for the students to take on their own. So, follow your school district's policies and procedures for medication administration. This is the second pearl, and the most important one. As nurses, as LVNs, as registered nurses, as advanced practice registered nurses, we are required to implement measures to promote a safe environment for our clients, which are our students and our staff, and others who come into the school building. And I know you guys have wonderful stories like this too, but we are not just taking care of those kids that come into the clinic, are we? I responded to a teacher who came running into my clinic one day at 3:30 at the end of the school day and said, "Melinda, there's a mother in labor in the parking lot." And I said, I grabbed my bag and I'm running, and I thought, oh, I wanted so badly to deliver a baby, you know, 30 years ago in labor and delivery in a small southwest corner of Oklahoma. And then I'm thinking, but I'm not really prepared to do that today, but I'm going to try. And I got out to the parking lot, and fortunately EMS got there before the baby. But I was counting contractions and I was monitoring the mother in the parking lot. We provide a safe environment, and the baby went to term. So they were able to stop this little mother's labor. She was waiting in the carpool line for her sixth grader. So we take care of everyone that's coming through the building or that parking lot. I've taken care of bus drivers who have had heart attacks. I'm sure you have as well. My very last day of school nursing before I started at the board, and I'm not sure what message was in this day. I don't know if it was to stay or to go, but a teacher came in early in the morning with chest pain, so we're on EMS, takes her to the local hospital, and I follow, which was our school district policy. And I'm there waiting with her until her family arrives. And I turn around and in comes another teacher with EMS with chest pain. So I spent the whole morning with two teachers with heart conditions in the ER. I get back to the campus after families had arrived and had taken over. And you know, we had walkie-talkies in 2005. They probably have cell phones now, but the school nurse had a walkie-talkie and the custodian, of course, because you need that custodian, and the building principals and associate principals. And so I'm listening to the walkie-talkie, and I hear my principal, my sweet, dear principal, say, Melinda, I need you in the parking lot. And I got my bag, and I'm running to the parking lot on the other side of the campus down by the gym, and a man in a dark black truck had driven down into the parking lot, pulled up alongside the curb, and had passed out. Doors were locked. Windows were really dark. It was very hard to see what was inside the car, who it was. But we could tell he was either asleep or unconscious or dead. Eventually, I could see the chest rising and falling. The doors were locked. And my principal said, we're not going to open the doors. We don't know what this is. We don't know if he's just come down here thinking someone at the school will help me or if it was a terroristic threat. So we waited for the police, who then, of course, you know, with mirrors are under the car trying to decide, are there bombs? And there weren't. And eventually EMS, they were able to open the door and get him out. He never responded, but they did not do CPR. So I knew he was still alive. But we made that choice that day to not intervene because of the safety of the school building and whether or not it was there was a bomb in the truck. So we never know what's going to happen in school health, but we are responsible to try to maintain that safe environment for schools. We are the safety officers in public school systems. We look at the safety of the playgrounds, what's in the vending machines, what health teachings occur. There are situations, though, where nurses fall down on their duty to protect student safety. And this is an example of a school nurse that failed to reassess the student that came into the school clinic. It was a little first grader who had fallen on the playground and fallen on his wrists. The teacher brought him in early in the morning to the school nurse, and he was crying and upset. There was no visible injuries to his wrists, but the school nurse put ice on and had him sit there for 20 minutes. Does that sound familiar? She sent him back to class, and he still didn't feel well. The teacher was kind of watching him. They went on to PE, and he still complained to the PE teacher, and the PE teacher said, well, you've been to the nurse, so why don't you just sit out here for a while and rest and just take it easy? And he did. He sat out during PE, and the teacher came back and picked him up, and he was still not feeling well. She said, well, let's go try lunch. He didn't eat anything at lunch. And after lunch, the teacher brought him back to the nurse and said, I'm worried. He didn't participate in PE. He didn't eat lunch. And the nurse said, well, his wrists look okay, but I'll send him back with you with another bag of ice, and she did. And as the day went on, the little child got on the bus to go home, and the mother heard him crying out on the front porch, and he was on the porch, sitting on the porch, you know, not able to move his arms. in pain. He couldn't open the door or ring the doorbell. She scooped him up, got him in the car. They went to the ER, and he had 2 broken wrists. And there wasn't a lot of visual damage. There wasn't a lot of injury visually. But what should the nurse have done? Called the parent. One of our rules of thumb, and it became a policy for our school district, was if we saw a child more than once, we called a parent. And I know many of you are parents as well, and I always use that as my barometer. Would I want to know that about my son? If my son came into the nurse for whatever reason it was, and he knew he should not go to the nurse. So if he did, I wanted to know about it. I would want to know about it. And all she would have had to do was that second time picked up the phone and called the mom and said, I'm worried he didn't participate in PE, he hasn't eaten lunch. They don't look injured, but he's still not feeling well. I think he should see the doctor, right? Simple, simple as that. Is it hard when you're seeing numerous kids during the day? You betcha it is. But that's the most important thing you do as school nurses. Standard A says we know all the laws that apply to our practice. And then I want to leave you with this most important tool. Many of you know this, the 6-step decision-making model for when you're in a quandary, when you've been asked to do something you don't know if you should, or whether it is in your scope of practice. It's a very easy 6-step question model with yes or no answers. We're going to use this question as an example of how to use it. School nurses ask us this often. Can I reinsert a permanently placed feeding tube? So some of you are saying no. Does anybody say yes? Some say yes, some say no. Okay, the first thing you ask yourself is it in the NPA, the rules and regulations, position statements, or guidelines? I'm going to tell you that this actually happened with me a while back with a school nurse while her administrator was there with her. So they both were able to do this at the same time. So it's not specifically mentioned in the Nursing Practice Act or the rules and regulations or a guideline. But there is a position statement that guides nurses on whether or not it is safe for you to reinsert a permanently placed feeding tube. This is where it's located on our website. These are the highlights of that position statement. You may, if it's through a well-established and healed fistulous tract, which is about 8 to 12 weeks, if there's a competency validation course, ongoing competency validation throughout the year, documentation of that competency, and there are policies and procedures. The second question is there a valid order or protocol? Is there an employment policy? And for this school nurse and the administrator that asked me this question, there was. They had a policy, they had a physician's order. So they got yes answers. So you keep moving through the model. If you had gotten a no answer, you stop. It's probably not within your scope of practice. The third question then asks you to look at the nursing literature. Is there evidence to support what you've been asked to do? This is where you look as school nurses. You look at the National Association of School Nurses. They have many position statements and issue briefs. The Texas School Nurse Organization, the Texas Department of State Health Services, and the Texas Nurses Association, many others. You all have UTMB also as a resource. Question 3 then asks, what's in the literature? Can you find information to support what you've been asked to do? Have you talked with pharmacists if it's related to a drug, a certain drug that you've been asked to administer? Can you find articles? What do other organizations or associations say? And the Society of Gastroenterology Nurses and Associates also has a position statement that guides nurses on the reinsertion. I've got a different version of software here, excuse me. So yes, they found evidence to support what that nurse could reinsert. The fourth one is, do you have the competency? And I want to stop here a minute. This is a friend of mine, a high school nurse in Round Rock, and she had 12 tube feedings between 11 and 1 p.m. during that lunch hour. And one-on-one aides with many of the students, as you can see here, they are assisting her. Remember, they are in her physical presence. This particular situation, she's not delegating. They are assisting her. She's overseeing. If she were in the other rooms with the other procedures going on, it would be delegation because she wasn't present. So delegation can be done with practice and skill. She was very good at it. So you ask yourself, are you skilled and competent in reinserting a permanently placed feeding tube? Possibly. This particular school nurse had not done it for over 20 years and didn't feel like she should do it again because she hadn't practiced. So remember, if you get a no, you stop. Would another nurse do what you've been asked to do? And this is where it is important that you establish that relationship with someone that you can call and talk those difficult situations with. Would another nurse do what you've been asked to do? And process that with them. I'm really off on my circles, aren't I? And then question six, are you prepared to assume the accountability and the responsibility for what you're about to do? So that's a personal question. You've got to decide, are you capable? Are you skilled? Do you have the order? Is there a policy? Because you are responsible once you undertake that procedure. This is contact information at the Board of Nursing if you need to reach us, and my personal contact information. And I, too, want to thank you as board staff for the wonderful work that you do as school nurses. And I hope that you never underestimate the influence and the difference you make in the lives of children here in Texas. You are the health leaders on your school campus and in your communities. And again, thank you for what you do, and have a wonderful rest of the day.